Okay, George R. R. Martin, you lost me. I mean, there's no way that an elite army of slaves could overthrow their masters and defeat massive armies of invaders to the east and the west with the help of the female heir to the empire and go on to rule for centuries from the largest city on the planet. Except the one time they did. Today's illustrative example, the Mamluk Sultan. What up? I'm Ben Freeman from freemanpedia.com. I run a website where I try to translate AP World Modern with maps and links and videos and charts. But far too often I run into examples that the College Board deems illustrative. But there's just not great resources out there on a certain topic, whether it's Champa Rice or today, the Mamluk Sultanate. They're either non-existent, they're too long or too lame or off topic or too specific or too vague. So I'm here to hook you with a succinct look at why the College Board thinks the Mamluk Sultanate is an illustrative example. If you stick around until the end, I'll give you some real-world examples from an SAQ, a DBQ, and an LEQ, all covering the Mamluk Sultanate. But you know I can't just randomly start talking to you about medieval Islamic slave armies. Let's do some contextualization. All right, so contextualization, as you know, is a big scary word that means you need to take this topic that we're talking about today and put it into context. You need to do this on the LEQ, you'll need to do this on the DBQ, and you'll need to do this on up to two of the SAQs on the exam in May. And it's relatively easy to do. It's the Star Wars crawl. It's the thing at the beginning that lets people know what you're talking about and kind of letting you into the world of the more specific thing that you'll be getting into. Don't randomly start talking about slave armies and their rise to power. It's confusing. You gotta tell your reader the historical context of what's going on, otherwise they'll be lost. It's the prequel. It's the backstory. It's why this is important and it's required. I'm gonna try and do this under a minute, so I haven't done it under a minute yet. And I talk and I talk and I talk, so I need a win today, so we're gonna go under a minute. Let's go. A minute on the clock. All right. AP World History starts with two units at the beginning, both covering 1200 to 1450. One is called the Global Tapestry. Global Tapestry is kind of a what's going on in all these small places. The networks of exchange is how those places connect, and then all the effects of all that stuff is just built in. The College Board focuses pretty heavily in Unit 1 on checking in different places, and for us, we're checking in on the Middle East, a place we like to call Dar al-Islam. The biggest change in the whole post-classical era, the 600 to 1450 historical era known as the post-classical era, is the arrival of Islam. Allah's final message was delivered to Muhammad, peace be upon him, in Arabia in the 7th century and quickly spread around the entire region. After Muhammad's death, the leadership in Islam passed on to the caliphs. The caliphs ruled the caliphates. The caliphates were the large regions that were controlled by the Arabs. Caliphs were tasked with being the leaders of not only the faith of Islam, but also the Arab empire that was building, and those areas that they ruled were called the caliphates. So after centuries of Islamic rule by the caliphates, including the 6th and 7th largest empires of all time, the caliphates began to lose land to emirates and sultanates and eventually the Mongols. With the caliphates gone, new Islamic entities began to emerge. And these new entities were no longer dominated by the Arabs, this time they're dominated by the Turks. And of all those groups that broke away from the caliphates, the most impressive, in my opinion, were the slave warriors that overthrew their masters to rule over Egypt and Islam's new capital, Cairo. This was the Mamluk Sultanate, and it offered a different political entity than the previous Islamic caliphates. Did we do it? We didn't do it. Okay. I'm not good at this. I don't know why I keep doing this. You think I would just keep recording it so that it would be under a minute, and then you would just think I was good at this. But no, I lost, and I'll take the L here. Sorry. So anyway, keep your contextualizations short. You don't need to go on. Just take the specific topic you're talking about and tie it into the larger scheme of things so that people know what's going on. All right, that's enough context. Time for the example. It all starts in a little place I like to call Egypt. When the course starts in the year 1200, Egypt is ruled by the Ayyubid Sultanate, and they rule for about a century. They're historically not super important globally, but you may know them for one reason. They were founded by a guy named Saladin. Saladin was a Sunni Muslim Kurd who you probably know for kicking out most of the Europeans from the Crusader states and eventually took back Jerusalem, if only briefly. Anyway, the Ayyubid Sultanate is the Ayyubid Sultanate because Saladin's last name was Ayyub, basically the Saladin Sultanate. But that's why they call it the Ayyubid Sultanate, so don't be afraid of words. It's just dude's last name. Like if there's a Freemanid Sultanate, it's just the guy's name. So Saladin and most of the Islamic world are having a labor problem. You've been really successful, your religion is spreading all over, it's doing fantastic, but you need slaves. And there's a caveat in Islam. You can't have Islamic slaves. So where does one get their slaves? You're gonna have to go beyond the borders of Dar al-Islam. Dar al-Islam, as a phrase you'll hear a lot, it's actually believe section 1.2, in the AP World CED, which once again I will link down below. And all it means is the world of Islam. So it's all the places, it's still a term today, it's all the places where Islam is in the majority. And so that's a big chunk of the planet. But you need slaves, and you can't have slaves because the population around you is Islamic. So where do you go? Well, the people before Saladin actually went into sub-Saharan Africa and got slaves that way. But then those people start converting as well, and so that's drying up as a source for your slaves. So where do you go? See, Saladin is different. He's a Kurd, and as a Kurd, he knows the Middle East and Central Asia, and he knows that if he needs slaves to be his warriors, there's no one better than a group that's new to the global stage, and those are the Turks. When you hear Turk, you're probably thinking the nation of Turkey or the Ottoman Turks. Those are kind of the famous ones. But there's a different Turk. But the Turks didn't just spontaneously generate in Constantinople in 1453. There are tons of groups of Turks. It's a very diverse community. And all of these groups are starting to move into the Middle East, into Dar al-Islam. And one of the ways they come in is via the slave trade. These aren't just random people from Central Asia. These are fierce warriors. These are some of the baddest fighters you're going to find on the planet. So Saladin could do a lot worse than going and getting some Turk warriors. These aren't, I have a sword, I have a shield, I'm going to fight you like that. This is state-of-the-art technology for the time. They're riding on horseback, which is the fastest a human can go at the time. And they are archers. So they're on the fastest transportation, and they have the fastest weapon at the time. I know what you're thinking. That's muskets. Wrong. The fastest weapon at the time was the bow and arrow. An arrow travels faster than a musket ball. And you've seen all those old movies where everyone takes 10 minutes to load a gun. Arrows you can just fire at a rapid pace, and these guys were expert marksmen and expert horsemen. So when you think of the Turks at this point, you kind of need to think of them as kind of like the Mongols. Not as scary as the Mongols, but having the same set of skills. So they're expert cavalry archers. If I'm drafting my post-classical army and I got the first pick, I'm obviously taking the Mongols. But if I have the second pick, I'm taking the Turks. Third pick, by the way, samurai. Always samurai. Anyway, the Turks that were brought back to Egypt as warrior slaves were called Mamluks. Mamluk's not a scary word. It literally just means someone who is possessed or someone who is enslaved. But you're probably an American, you're probably thinking slavery, you're probably thinking chattel slavery and the horrors of the Atlantic slave trade. This is very, very different. You're being brought in as a warrior to help defend Cairo. And when they get to Cairo, they are elite. They have the best training, the best schools, converted to Islam, and then freed. They would actually call their former masters father and were treated like members of the family. And within Egyptian society, they held an elite rank amongst everyone else. They were respected. So don't think of them in the same level as slaves that were treated as property. These guys were very high up on the hierarchy in Egypt. And no, they weren't castrated like the Janissaries or the Unsullied in Game of Thrones. So that's a different Turks. That's the Ottomans. So that'll come later. Think of them as Mongol-type warriors with unparalleled fighting capabilities that are then brought from the periphery and trained in all sorts of government tasks, bureaucracy, the military, trade, statesmanship, all different things they're responsible for because they're the elite of the elite. So how did Turkish military slaves from Central Asia become the rulers of Egypt and the largest city on the planet? That's an excellent question. I'm glad you asked. So Saladin dies, and like a lot of empires in history, the first guy is awesome. And then everyone else is kind of like not so awesome. And so in about 90 years, it all falls apart. But throughout that 90 years, you have this elite military working for you. And those are the Mamluks. All right, I'm not gonna say this again in AP World History, so this is a one-time thing. Luckily, the Europeans invaded Africa. Oh, it sounds weird. It feels weird to say. I don't like it, but it's true. Predating all of this, the Crusades were the Europeans' attempt to retake the Holy Land, specifically Jerusalem, but in reality, anywhere in the Middle East they could grab. The first few Crusades were massive wars fought between two rivaling cultures in an effort to see who would dominate the region. But you know, like when they make a movie and the first couple movies are really good and then the last ones you're like, what are you doing? Like, what's happening? Well, that also happens in wars. Case in point, the Seventh Crusade. Yeah, and there were more than that, but let's just talk about the seventh one. Which, by the way, if I'm ranking crusades, this is one of my favorite ones because it's ridiculous. This crusade was led by a French king named Louis, and it's not one you've heard of. It's Louis the Ninth. So he's really only known for this and because of how ridiculous this whole thing turned out. I'll save you the specifics. He invades Egypt. He takes one town, then gets destroyed by the Mamluks. I don't know how he didn't see that coming. There's an elite warrior group just sitting there in Egypt, and he just comes and knocks on the door expecting them to bow to the French king. That's not what the Mamluks do. Come on. So that's a lame story, but that's not how it ends. He himself gets captured by the Mamluks and ransomed off back to France, which they have to pay. And they do pay, and it's roughly a third of France's entire economy has to go not towards defending or helping people, but to getting the kickback because he decided to go on his own crusade. But how does it tie into the Mamluks? So in that same battle where they captured the French king and held him ransom for a third of their entire economy, the last Ayyubid Sultanate actually had an abscess in his leg. And of course, to fix an abscess in your leg, you saw your leg off. And spoiler alert, he died. So the Sultan's dead. So who's in charge? The leader of the Mamluks married the last Ayyubid Sultan's wife, the Sultana, and now the Mamluks are in charge of Egypt, thus beginning the Mamluk Sultanate in the year 1250. Maybe Egypt should stop taking slaves. Like, I know two slave stories about Egypt that both don't end well for the rulers in Egypt, so. Okay, we know who the Mamluks are, but why does the College Board think they're important enough to make sure that you know them as an illustrative example? So the Mamluks are an illustrative example of a new political ruling style in the Islamic world after the demise of the caliphates. And of course, all the other sultanates and emirates and other Islamic groups that pop up look down on the Mamluks for being what they called the sons of slaves, or how dare they rule over Mecca and Medina. Now, of course, they wouldn't say that to their face because they're Mamluks, and as you can see, they've been destroying all challengers lately. So Mamluks took the title Sultan. Now, Sultan is just leader. Sultan is an Islamic leader who rules an area. Now, they do not claim to rule the faith. If they did, they would be the caliph. So a caliph rules an area and is in charge of the faith. However, a sultan rules an area but does not claim dominion over all of Islam. Think of the sultan to caliph relationship the same way you would the pope to a king situation. It's kind of similar. So the leader of the Mamluk is a sultan, and it's not hereditary. They actually hold elections when the sultan dies amongst the elites, and they pick who the next sultan is. Now, they tend to pick people that are in the same family, but it's not guaranteed that the next son is going to be in charge, and it's not guaranteed you'll be in charge for a long time. The record holder for shortest sultan reign is less than a year. So another way they're different from the caliphates is where they rule from. They rule from Cairo, which at the peak of Mamluk rule is the largest city on earth. Now, they are the largest city on earth around the year 1300, which I know what you're thinking if you're doing the math. That means a lot of other cities were destroyed by the Mongols. But either way, Cairo was not destroyed by the Mongols. Why were they not destroyed by the Mongols? They weren't destroyed by the Mongols because of the Mamluks. This city was visited by all kinds of people. Ibn Khaldun called it the capital of Islam at the time. Ibn Battuta called it the mother of cities. So this is a really big deal city, not just population-wise, but for influence and impact around Dar al-Islam. In fact, if you go to Cairo today, go to the old city, what they call the old city of Cairo. That skyline around the old city, that's the Mamluk skyline. These guys put this city on the map. Now, another way they're different is because they are Turks, the Mamluk Turks that come in. When they get married, they often marry Arab women in Egypt. So there's an entire class of people that emerge from this called the Sons of Mamluks. And the Sons of Mamluks had descendancy from both educated Arab elites and the warriors of the Mamluks. And so they kind of grew up in this wealth and used this power and training to become poets and authors and architects and historians. And so there's a lot we know about the Mamluks versus other groups that we wouldn't have known otherwise because it's that blending of those two cultures, Arabs and Turks, which is really the story of Islam after the fall of Baghdad in 1258. New blood being brought into the faith, a belief system that was formerly dominated by the Arabs now bringing in new groups. So what was originally an Arab religion is now becoming a more worldly religion. Another way they're different or similar, I guess, from the old caliphates is they bring the caliph back. The last Abbasid caliph was rolled up in a carpet and killed by the Mongols, which is one of the ways they like to kill important people. But the Mamluks found his uncle, brought him in as their caliph, so you would have a caliph and a sultan. Caliph's kind of a figurehead. Think of the way the Pope has power today. The caliph had that. It was really just so that the sultan would have legitimacy over his realm. Now, the Mamluks aren't around anymore, and the reason that is because they ran into a bigger, badder, more modern version of the Turks known as the Ottomans. The Ottomans bring artillery and Janissaries. That's much later, but that's kind of where they go. Okay, you know who the Mamluks are. You know what a sultan is. You know why the Mamluks are an example of a different political ruling style than, say, the caliphates that had come before them. But let's see if you can use it on an actual exam example. I lied. There are no exam examples. If you go through all of the AP World History exams, even back to 2002 when the course started, there's nothing there. They don't come up, they're not mentioned, and part of that is they're new to the newest CED, and the reason for that is twofold. Number one, this is brand new to the course. They don't exist in past versions of the course. This new CED has only been around for almost 2 years, so they really haven't had the chance to put them on the test. But, hear me out, let's play devil's advocate here. So, the College Board has a brand new illustrative example that they've never asked a question about from a group in the Islamic Dar al-Islam world that are an anomaly. They're the only slave army that ever really rises up and rules over such a major part of the world and does so for centuries, and they've never even brought it up on an exam or as a possible answer on an SAQ, an LEQ, or a DBQ. What I'm thinking is, this could be the year of the Mamluks. Let's face it, it wouldn't be the first time the Mamluks were underestimated. All right, thanks for watching. Once again, I'm Ben Freeman from Freemanpedia.com. I made two of these now. It's pretty impressive, right? I'll keep posting these as many as I can throughout the school year. Again, I'm a real teacher, so I have real other things to do. So when I get to a part where I'm like, wait, this isn't here, I'll try to fill it in with a video like this. So if you want to get these as soon as I post them, click subscribe and let me know how I'm doing. Are these helping? I don't know. Are they? Is there anything else you want included in these videos? I don't know. I'm just sitting here in my living room with my dog snoring behind a camera. Anyway, let me know in the comments below. So good luck on the exam in May, and I'll see you next time.